trout out there, just behind those weeds. It's a nice fish, I think. Just saw it rise. I think I'll have a go at that. I might catch it. Because I might not.
I've spent some of my happiest hours fishing. It's one of my biggest regrets that I haven't done more of it. But why go fishing in the first place? Most people, at some point in their childhood, have dipped a net in the water and wondered about what lurked in the depths. And for some people, this is where it ends. But for the angler, it's just the beginning. Of course, there's a fascination for the fish themselves, with their variations of shape and eccentricities of behaviour. But is fishing simply about catching them, or nearly catching them? Or is there something more to it than that? John Bailey, lifelong lover of barbel, is out looking for monsters.
The very peak of fishing, I think, is when you're on your own, because then there is no human contact and you can become totally at one with the river. You're just merged in with it, and it's you and the river, and the rest of the world doesn't exist.
Here's an angler's dream. A summer dawn, a beautiful river, and the fish are biting.
I just love catching barbel. They're so big, they're so hard fighting.
My arm's aching after that. There's something about a barbel at dawn that I think they fight harder at dawn than any other time. I think they're so busy with breakfast that they just haven't got a clue that anybody would be up so early trying to catch them. I don't know how big it is, it doesn't really matter. It's just such a lovely, lovely fish. 7, perhaps 8 pounds. Oh, big barbel on a misty dawn. You just can't have anything better in a fisherman's life.
Yes, well, a trout would be quite nice. But it's the challenge that's important, you see.
Different fly this time. Tup's indispensable. Can't fail.
You so nearly succeed. The fish is there on the end of the line.
Blast.
How can something so frustrating be so universally popular? It can't just be peace and quiet and idyllic surroundings.
I love fishing, mate. I've been fishing since I was 7 years of age. And I'm 50 now. I just love it. And it gets me away from the dragon.
The dragon?
The wife.
All over the country, wherever there's a stretch of water, there will be men gathered together, escaping from dragons and looking for monsters. Perhaps that's what it's all about. Well, maybe they're not all monsters, but the excitement of catching them is the same. A shoal of roach in a city river has an attraction of its own.
It's a roar, a decent roar. Shit. Right, okay, I'll just get rid of that. Six owls. It's got pretty eyes. It's quite a reasonable fish. You'd be happy catching these all day long.
It's just absolutely addictive.
It's the excitement of stalking the unpredictable. And roach are unpredictable, as every angler knows.
That was before Sea Roach.
There's nothing like it. Nothing in the world. No dragon. Just me and me mates.
As a small boy, I started fishing when I was six. My first walleye that I experienced was a small pond behind a house in a field. It was a muddy little pond the cattle drink. And I looked at that and was bemused, fascinated by the thought of what life there must be in there. And I thought of creatures with shining, jeweled eyes, you know. And I was in love with it instantly.
Bernard Venables, the grand old man of British fishing, whose Mr. Crabtree books introduced generations to the mysteries of rod and line, still catching fish in his 90th year. For him, the delight of fishing lies in the beauty of the fish themselves.
If you look intelligently, with a naturalist's eye, at a fish, you can tell why it's the shape it is. If it's a beautiful fish, they're all beautiful. You know why it has that particular sort of beauty. Take the case of a perch. The perch is a very beautiful fish, a lovely flaring fish. But that all comes for a very practical need. It is a predator. It has to have camouflage so that its prey may not see it before it can catch them. Everything about a perch is strictly practical. Nature making the thing for the greatest possible practical use makes something of the greatest possible beauty. It just always works out that way. Fishing is applied natural history. Here you have the water. You know there are fish in it. You have to persuade them to buy it. You must so insert yourself into their natural way of life so that when your bait does come to them, it appears to be a part of nature. They accept it as naturally as they take anything that comes any day. A huge fish.
Maybe that's the secret of happiness. Understanding fish, the better to outwit them.
Tiny perch.
And when you do know fish, then you begin to get choosy. Instead of the instant gratification of catching any fish, the excitement comes from the pursuit of one in particular. Perhaps you're naturally drawn to the fish that most suits your own personality.
I prefer a tench above all other fish. I think they're nice in their own way. They're clean-looking fish and just sort of attractive without being flashy. Yes, I do. Different fish have different characters. Perch, for example, are always chasing around, but tench are patrolling constantly, just gradually going across the bottom. They're not in a hurry to get anywhere. Not in a hurry to do anything, really. This end of the bread is for the tench, and the other end is for me when I make my soup later on. I'm using the crust here because it will float up off the bottom. You've got to find out where they are in the water, and you've got to get the right bait into wherever they are. So on a water like this one, where there aren't very many tench, it's hard work. Tench are basically bottom feeders. They cruise along and pick up stuff from on the bottom, and hopefully they get within range of this and they can smell the scent of the stuff that's in the mixture, and it will bring them to it and entice them to feed.
Not easy, considering that tench are the most cautious, suspicious fish and will certainly not take a bait in a hurry. But then half the pleasure of fishing is about waiting for something to happen.
Oh, you have to be very patient when you're fishing for tench. Certainly when you're fishing with me for tench. You know, you can fish for a whole weekend and perhaps get one, maybe two bites, and now and then you lose them. So it's, yes, a matter of patience, really. And
yes, patience. Endless patience. That's what fishing is all about.
You show me a patient fisherman, I'll show you a bloke without any fish at all. It's about the last thing you want is patience. This is the trickiest bit. If you're dead patient, you do nothing. If you're impatient, you keep altering your techniques, trying something different.
No one can ever say that fishermen aren't inventive.
This is a float tube. It's a sophisticated inner tube from a lorry tyre. That's all we've got here. The way fish see, if you're high above the surface, they can see everything. They can see you a long way away. They'll take evasive action. With a tube, you're so low down that they come in very, very close to you. You can usually get two or three shots at them if they're rising in the top before they see you and sheer off. They probably don't realise what you are. They probably think you're a large black duck from underneath. What we're fishing for today is rainbow trout. They don't have eyelids. They tend to go down deep when it's hot. So I'm dragging bizarre looking creations along within a foot of the floor, as it were, 30 feet down. Trying to get a fish to grab hold of it, a fish that doesn't really want to feed, a fish that's laying where it's most comfortable and really couldn't give a damn about what we're trying to do for them today. What we tend to do with fly fishing certainly is we make the game, and it is a game, hard by not using bait. That's sort of fundamental part of fly fishing. That's what we do. We do it to make it hard. There is an enormous amount of mystery, and the mystery is not knowing why things happen and trying to find out. We don't really know why fish take hold of flies and bite them. Until you actually get reincarnated as a fish, you will not know. I'm not happy if I'm not catching fish. I know very few really good fishermen who are happy catching nothing. They catch nothing, they'll be altering all the techniques as fast as they can go. Did you catch anything?
No, not yet.
But I'm not unhappy. I haven't caught anything. But that's not everything.
It really is more to do with what you might catch. It's what could be just a little bit further along, just down there. It's about what might be just about to happen.
Thank you.
the rain hasn't ruined the fishing. The rain should improve the fishing now. This time of year when the water is all hot and stuffy, and you get a bit of rain down and a good wind, and it stirs it all up and makes the fish more active. Yes. Yes, it will do the fishing a bit of good, I think. People see fishermen sitting in the rain and they wonder what's happening, but in fact the fisherman is probably getting the best of it because, as I say, the water is activated a little bit. The fish tend to move around and start feeding when this happens. So it's a good idea to stay out when it rains. I don't feel like packing up and going home quite yet. I think I'd like to have a night of it and see what it's like in the morning. I'm hoping.
Eternal optimism. It's the angler's secret weapon. If you want to be happy, learn to fish, as they used to say in ancient China.
I think that any good fisherman just has to know about the behaviour patterns of the fish that he's seeking. It is possible, I suppose, to fish blind without this sort of knowledge, but you don't really enjoy what you're doing, I don't think. Real satisfaction comes with knowing exactly how the fish behave. Barbel can be shy. They can be very, very shy indeed. They can hide in weed, they can hide under rocks, under tree roots. Sometimes you'd hardly know they're a barbel in a stretch, but you can just never tell. That's why I'm casting my float round this rock, working my bait close in, hoping to find them there. Whenever possible, I always like to fish holding the line because it's the link between me and the fish. And when you hold the line, you can feel a real electricity running up and down it. You can feel the bodies of the barbel brushing against it. Suddenly, you're aware that there are barbel close to your bait. You can feel the line just begin to vibrate. It's as though those whiskers are running up and down it. And then suddenly, the whole thing changes and there's a ponderous power. And suddenly, before you know it, the rod's hooped over and the reel's screaming and you're in the river and you're the happiest man alive. So beautiful, they're so unmarked. Everything about them is absolutely perfect. These big fins of theirs, these big petrels that they used to clamping them to the bottom with all manner of floods. They used to such great effect as fighting fish. Absolute dream to catch. You notice in these stiller, slower reaches that they've got quite a few fish lice on them. And occasionally, when I do catch a fish like this, I'll just let it recover in the shallows like this and just get the worst of them off. I don't think it does them any harm at all, but if you can help a barbel for giving you so much pleasure, I think it's small return. Horrible little things. Barbel like this gives its all in the fight, and in hot weather especially. Terribly, terribly important to nurse them in the current. Let the water go through their gills, let them build up their strength again. And once you feel the power course through their bodies, once you begin to feel their muscles flex, their fins begin to move, then they're probably safe to go back. But it can be a long business.
Perhaps it is something about having contact with fish. just having the chance to see them when most of the time they're invisible. Maybe it's the simple excitement of bringing one out of the water, over the net, and into your very hands. It's like a magician's trick, the invisible made to appear, like a rabbit from a hat.
There he is, the most beautiful perch. See his great dorsal fin. And very sharp those spines are through many a small boyer's. Got a bleeding hand from those. And see these lovely coral fins. And these handsome black bars. And those beautiful fish. Off he goes. Back to his native element. A fisherman, in a sense, doesn't choose to go fishing. He obeys the summons. It's a passion. He's got to respond. He's got to do it. It's one of the fundamental impulsions. He's just got to do it.
I stay all day and all night. Tend to come down, say, Friday afternoon and go home Sunday evening. Stayed out for up to a week at a time at the beginning of the season, and it's nice to get home and have a bath.
What does your wife think of that?
She's used to it. I've always done it. So, I mean, she's used to it. Her friends think it's a bit strange. The peak periods for fishing are dawn and dusk, and the big ones tend to be caught at night. So the fish, hopefully now, are moving around looking for my bait. Hopefully they smelt my bait, they smelt my ground bait, and they're coming around looking for the hook bait. Well, I'm going to be caught by it. First bite tonight, I missed it. Fishing is more fun and a challenge when it's difficult than when you're catching fish all the time. And when you catch something, it's a real achievement. It's not just another fish on the hook.
Is this complete and utter madness? Why do we go to such extraordinary lengths when the odds against catching are so high? Perhaps it's an ancient hunting instinct that still drives the mildest of us. Or is fishing quite simply the exquisite hope of triumph over failure?
Be a nice one. It's got a nice pull anyway. She comes. Yeah. Yes, it's a tench. Only a small one though. Never mind. Lovely little male tench with the big spoon-like fins there, and the red eyes, of course, that all tench have, the dark green back and the orange stomach. Beautiful fish, isn't it? Not a big one, but a lovely fish, well worth waiting up for. And the next one will be the big one. Off he goes.
Nice day.
It's the gift of a fisherman that he never really grows up. If he's a fisherman, you know that somewhere the child has remained in him. And I think possibly that is the single most obvious benefit of being a fisherman. So many of the things that delight us in water are the things of childhood.
The pursuit of fish is a strong and ancient compulsion. It's about escape and solitude and companionship and the pure excitement of a catch. It takes hold of your mind and makes you stay on the bank when, like generations of anglers before, you should have gone home hours ago, simply because success will surely come with just one more cast.
Oh, what a cracking fish!
The opening day of the salmon fishing season. Rivers throughout the length and breadth of Britain are blessed. Anglers across the country gather together and get down to business with a wee dram and a request for some divine assistance.
O Lord above, who sends us fish to swim their silvery way, we ask you now for blessing upon this opening day. Please bless the flies and bless the lures that fish they may entice. An occasional 40-pounder here. Dear God, that would be nice.
On a bitter January morning, whiskey is the perfect antidote to cold. But first they will honour their noble foe by giving it one for the rod. If nothing else, it might just get the fish in a better mood. With the first cast, the season begins in earnest. They call the Atlantic salmon the king of fish. And it's no wonder. Salmon anglers will pay hundreds of pounds for the privilege of fishing for one. They aren't easy to catch. They can travel the entire length of the river system through the year, so you can never be sure where they are or whether they're in the mood to take your lure. To catch your fish, you must first do your homework. It's essential to be able to read the river like a book. An intimate knowledge of its natural history can mean the difference between success and failure. One man who makes his living reading this part of the River Wye is fishing gilly George Woodward.
Ever since I was a small child, I've always been interested in fishing. Actually, I can't remember a time when I didn't fish by either a little net or small rod and line. Got very friendly with the two gillies that was working here in those days, helped them out for a period of time. And when one of the old gillies retired, I got the opportunity to become a full-time gillie on the river.
Right, let's go and see what we can do. It's a grand morning anyway.
It's lovely.
Good condition though, it's nice and clear.
It is clear.
One of the things with having a gillie with you, you've got the person who has expert knowledge of the bait he fishes on, knows exactly where to take a rod, where he's got a good chance of taking a fish, to have a good knowledge of his bait.
Right, this rod is.
To be there to help and assist the fisherman.
We had 28.5 pounder at Monmouth on the Dukes, I believe, over the weekend.
Did they?
Of course, you're involved in the river 7 days a week, 365 days a year. There's not a day goes by that I'm not down here. So you see the variations in the year.
Each new season brings change to the river. Eggs that were laid on the gravel bed during winter hatch out early in the year. Although tiny, these fry are the key to a successful season. They themselves won't be big enough to catch until they're 4 or 5 years old. But already their scent in the water acts as a marker, helping attract adult salmon returning from the sea to find their home river, and making sure that the fishermen of today have something to fish for. During the first quarter of the year, the springfish run upriver. For George and Mr. Hodges, fishing companions of old, springfish are the perfect prize, fresh from the sea and full of vigour.
Well, that's sort of covering where fish should be. They tend to lie all the way down this run here, yeah. And cover that quite well.
On this stretch, salmon tend to lie up near the bank, beneath overhangs of rock. This gives them access to a steady current of oxygen-rich water, whilst allowing them to rest before pushing on for the journey ahead. It also gives the experienced fisherman a clue as to where to try his luck.
Keep your eye up and down in the pool there, just in case we can see anything. Towards the rock there. Nice to see a fish show.
Mm.
At least it gives you that encouragement then. You know there's one there, gets the adrenaline going, and there's a chance for us.
But just because you can see a fish doesn't mean that it will deign to take your particular lure.
What's your theory, Mr. Rogers, why a fish takes a fly or a lure or a bait when, as we know as fishermen, once our Atlantic salmon enter fresh water, they cease to feed?
I think it's in anger. It sees something passing by. It hasn't got a hand to put up to catch hold of it, so it takes it in its mouth.
Possibly territorial instinct comes in. You've got a salmon, he's moved up river, he's found a place on the bed of the river where he's quite happy to lie behind a rock or a depression in the bed of the river, and for the period of time he's stopping there, that's his little home, isn't it? And
yeah.
He doesn't really want anything else interfering with him, and he's quite happily led there at peace with the world. All of a sudden around the front of his nose comes something flickering and dancing. He thinks, I'm not getting that in my nest or my bed or whatever he terms it. Boom.
No one really knows why the fish bite when they don't eat. But what George does know is that these springfish lie up in deep water. So it's time to make an adjustment.
We'll just retie your
lure and put a heavier weight on, Mr. Rogers.
Cool.
When I first saw one, I thought, I'm not going to catch a bloody salmon on that damn thing. But they really are quite effective.
The adult salmon may not feed in the river, but the young fish do. After 2 years as fry, the little salmon change. They are now known to fishing folk as parr. They spend their time in the riffles and runs of the river, feeding on anything small and tasty that comes their way. They're not the only ones interested in a fish supper. On some parts of the Wye, they share the water with an animal who is extremely fond of all things fishy. As well as for sport, otters were once killed because they ate game fish like salmon. Now, thankfully, seeing an otter during a day's fishing is considered a bonus. And like most fishermen, George doesn't seem to mind a bit of natural poaching from the otters he sees on the river.
On beats in the river, particularly the upper Wye, where there are quite a few otters, they'll leave the track along the river bank, footprints in the mud. We also see where they've caught fish and the occasional salmon. I think you'd be a very, very sad sort of individual if you couldn't tolerate an otter taking your occasional salmon.
After all, watching wildlife is one of the best ways to while away the time as you wait for the salmon to take.
And whitetails down there then, all the time after those flies that are hatching. Must eat millions in a week. Because the nymph of those flies spend a period of time as a nymph on the bed of the river. And as they start to mature, get ready for hatching, they swim up to the surface of the water, hatch out on the surface, take off to fly off. And that's when those whitetails are waiting for them. I always feel sorry for the poor mayflies because their mayfly nymph can spend about 3 years on the bed of the river, slowly growing. And they only live 24 hours. Just imagine, poor old mayfly, all it wants to do is survive. It survives everything on the bed of the river, all the fish that want to eat it. Starts to swim up as a nymph, thinking, right, get to the surface of the water, I'm going to hatch out. I'll be full 24 hours bonking, reproduce me kind, and then I'm going to die, but I'll be happy. Poor little bugger hatches out, goes lifts 3 or 4 inches off the water, whoop, fine wagtail, swallow has it. Poor little fellas.
Perhaps that's the beauty of life on the river. You can never tell what's up ahead.
There is many a time, God, I wish I knew whether I'm putting me bait near a fish. I wish there was a fish down there. And then you think, no, that's not going to be fishing. You wouldn't have the same excitement, the same tension, the same adrenaline surge when all of a sudden it happened.
That's it.
Well done, you're in. Keep the rod up. Keep the rod up. Get a good bend in the rod. Well done. Keep your rod up. Makes it all worthwhile, this, Mr. Rogers.
He's quite lively, George.
Yeah, that's a good fish. Good fresh fish. Not too hard on him, it took us a while to hook him. Just take your time with it.
You don't think it's a barbel, do you, George?
No, really not, it's no barbel. Tiring now. This is almost at the dangerous stage now when you start getting close to the boat, isn't it, Mr. Rogers?
Very dangerous.
Shorter line. And just bring your rod over my back there. A bit shorter. That's it. It's coming in. Nice fish. Thank you. It's a good fish. It's a cock fish anyway.
Is it?
Yeah. Well done, Mr. Rogers. There we are. Nice, fresh cock Wye salmon.
What a lovely fish.
Sea lice all over him, look. It hasn't been long up the river.
Very fresh.
Good fish. Well done, sir.
Right, we'll put him in the locker. I'll tell you what. Wait, see, there's another one out there for us. That's another thing about fishing. That might be the only one of the day. Might be just the start. Couple more, you never know. The river looks good.
As spring turns to summer, the young salmon parr that have spent 2 to 3 years growing now change into silvery smolt. But the river can no longer support their increasingly large appetites. It's time for them to make their way to the Atlantic and the feeding grounds of the adults. Most of them will stay in their family shoals for the journey to the sea, and those that survive will tend to return together in the same group. For fish only a few centimetres long, careering over waterfalls and struggling to swim through white water is a hazardous occupation. This journey downstream will take a far greater toll on their numbers than the long haul back upriver when they return to lay their eggs. As the smolt head out to sea, George and Mr. Hodges are pondering the meaning of life. And fishing, of course.
What makes a good fisherman, George?
That's a damn good question, Mr. Hodges. Good fisherman. Well, his skill, patience, ingenuity and intelligence made a good fisherman. Why the hell do women catch him?
What does Mary McCallum think of that?
I think women are better than men at fishing, although it's a sweeping generalisation, is that women have far more patience and tenacity than men. They spend more time with their fly in the water, and so consequently, they stand a better chance of catching a fish. Most of the men I know spend far too much time contemplating which fly to put on, which bank to fish from, which spot to choose, whether to have another coffee before they start, whether to have a quick 40 winks after lunch. But I think a lot of women, because they're so practical, will just get on with the job.
Controversial stuff. But it's true that women seem to catch the biggest fish. One theory puts it down to good old-fashioned lust. The scent of a woman drives the fish wild. The theory goes that we all give off chemicals called pheromones, different ones depending on if we're male or female. Some fishermen think that the big male salmon smell women anglers. The scent passing from her hands onto the line and lure. This feminine fragrance sends the male fish into such a frenzy that he takes the lure.
The record for the biggest salmon, I'm delighted to say, was caught by a lady, very famous fisher, Miss Georgina Ballantyne. It was about 64 pounds in weight, but who knows, there might be another one just around the bend in the river.
So, the moral of this story, gentlemen, is... put away your fishing toys, If you want to catch a fish to rival Miss Ballantyne's 4.5-foot monster, perhaps you should ask a woman to lend you a hand. With the passing of summer, Mary and her fellow anglers will continue the search for their big fish. After all, he must be out there somewhere, waiting for them. After 2 years or so at sea, the adult salmon must return to their home river to spawn, finding their way, we think, by using the Earth's magnetic field and the river's unique scent. This is the time of year when George is at his busiest, as the bulk of the fish begin their difficult journey back upriver.
Once your salmon has entered the river system, you've got a predation possibly with small salmon, with mink, the occasional fish are taken by otters. Quite a large percentage are taken by salmon anglers, and also we've got the problem on the Wye of poaching.
Poachers can clear a pool of up to 50 fish in one night, and that can earn them a lot of money.
It's quite easy and quite simple for a small gang of people to make 400, 500, 600, 700, 800 to £1,000 a night for a few hours poaching on the river.
River bailiffs work with the gillies to stop poachers taking the salmon. With night scopes and radios, it may look like boys with toys, but if it weren't for the bailiffs, there would be precious few salmon left for the fishermen.
Spotted target, 50 metres downriver, heading in your direction, Robert.
It is no use going in on a riverbank and hiding up in bushes or long grass with a little bright fluorescent uniform that says, bailiff. It's very easy to level the finger and say, God, look at these people. They look like a load of paramilitaries or people playing war games. A well-camouflaged bailiff on the riverbank can have a poacher within a few feet of him, and hopefully the poacher's not going to know he's there. You wait till the time is right, possibly where the poacher is just coming out onto the riverbank with his haul of salmon, and it's go, go, go.
Go, go, go!
The bailiff force moves in.
Arresting you for poaching.
I don't know about being macho. I thoroughly enjoy every last minute of it.
Those that don't end up in a poacher's freezer continue their journey upstream. For many fishermen, this is the most impressive time of the year, as the salmon run up the same waterfalls they came down as smolt. They don't all make it up the waterfalls. Some just don't have enough energy and will die of exhaustion on the way. For fly fishing expert Bob Brownless, this is the best time of year to practice his art.
The lovely thing about fly fishing is the fact that your rod becomes an extension of your arm, and you every time you're trying to get that fly just a little bit further or drop her into a nice spot just beside a stone and fooling the fish into thinking it's a natural fly. It's a more of a skill than a mechanical process. When you do get the strike of a salmon, it's the ultimate way to catch a salmon with a screaming reel on it. Oh, here we go. We're in. That's him.
So strong.
We've got a build-up of salmon as the year goes on. They're all queuing up for their spawning grounds.
Not for giving in, this one.
They've actually seen every bait, every lure on their way up the river, and these are the real survivors, so they're doubly hard to catch.
On your beauty. Coming up for you, I think, Mary. Must be the pheromones, eh?
Well, I reckon. It's the secret dropper.
Yeah. You're going to come down this side.
No.
He's coming towards us. He's way back out again. I mean, I've had about over 3,000 fish in my life and I still get the same thrill out of it. It's just fantastic, you know? The thing is, you can go for days and days, sometimes weeks and weeks, and not get a salmon. And then when you do, it's such a surprise, you know? And he's going downstream again, back to his lie. Right, and it goes under this boat. Yeah. Got that?
Yep.
Thank you. Right, and hard that fish, Mary.
Oh, beauty. What a cracker.
Oh,
yep. Yeah. Well done, that man. What a cracker.
There you go. One salmon. Once you've caught your first salmon, the bug doesn't leave you. You've got to be out there in all weathers, all conditions, from January through to November, chasing the elusive salmon.
As autumn arrives, the chase comes to an end for Bob. For him and his fellow fishermen across the country, it is time to pack up and head for home.
We've reached now the end of our salmon fishing season on the Wye. We're now into mid-October. Within a few weeks now our salmon will start to spawn the upper reaches, and on numerous beats now up and down the river. Gillies will now be getting their boats off the river, fishing rods will be taken down, cleaned, varnished, new rings possibly put on them, stored away till the opening day next season. I think autumn's a nice time to reflect back on the season that's gone and how good or how bad it was. Fish you caught, people you met and talked with, and look forward to the next season. And we all hope it's going to be that little bit better and we're going to catch more fish or see more fish, or there's going to be more fish in the river. Oh, I'm sure with a majority of the fishermen at the end of the season, though they've had a lot of pleasure in catching a salmon, there's nothing far nicer than inviting his friends to a nice party and to say, look at this 20-pound salmon I caught on the River Wye, and now we're going to sit down and enjoy eating it.
Fishing stops for November and December to leave the salmon to spawn in peace. This also gives the fishermen a chance to sit and reflect on the season and perhaps to reminisce about the one that got away. And to sample what they've spent all those months fishing for. But after toasting any fish, it's worth reflecting on those pearls of wisdom from the people who know best.
You've never caught a fish till you've got it on the plate with the chips around it.
How true. Pike fishing is not like sitting by a village pond on a sunny Sunday catching tiddlers. It's an adventure. Pike are predators. They're rare. They're dangerous. They're not everyone's favourite, but pike anglers relish the challenge that comes from trying to overcome this formidable fish.
It's the ultimate challenge. They grow bigger than any other species. They fight harder. The supreme predator. They're very much a misunderstood creature and in many ways much maligned.
But to most people, even some anglers, the pike is a bad, bad fish. And it looks the part. The sinister camouflage body, the prehistoric head, the huge toothed jaws. Its victims are the weak, the young and the incautious, slashed to pieces by the hundreds of needle-sharp teeth. And it is said pike can grow large enough to swallow a full-grown mallard in one. Whether deserved or not, the pike's reputation draws a certain sort of angler into an obsessive pursuit. David Overy is a pure pike addict.
I've always been fascinated by predatory creatures of any description. And when you take to angling, pike are the supreme predator in freshwater. Most people who perhaps don't understand them think that they're fearsome creatures to be despised, a bit like wolves. I don't see it. I think they're extremely, exquisitely beautiful creatures. And perhaps the most amazing thing for me is the fact that they can grow so large. I mean, walk into any pub in any of the local villages and you see a very, you know, leviathans on the wall, you know.
More than any other, pike fishing seems to lend itself to myth and legend. And when it comes to tall tales of the monster that got away, the Blarney is at its best. Drop into Eddie's Lochside Bar, admire the leviathan on the wall, and hear him tell a true tale or two.
I myself caught a pike years ago. Well, when I say caught, I nearly caught a pike. 45-pound break of strength on my line. Beautiful calm day. Pike took the bait, played him for an hour, and he broke the line. So he must have been 50 plus. And that was a huge pike. That's my biggest pike. But there is big pike there. There has to be.
The vast lochs on the west coast of Ireland have a long history of being perfect pike habitat. Here, in Loch Corrib, they have a reputation for growing huge. And wherever there are stories of big pike, pike anglers are close behind. Finding big pike is tricky. Pike are secretive, skulking fish that love to sidle along weed beds, lurking and creeping until the prey is close. They are predators par excellence, but they're like an easy meal, a victim in trouble. The secret is offering them something that looks like a soft touch. Then you might lure the monster out. But you can't expect a big pike to come to you, and you can't expect to catch them on a worm. You need something like this, a lure that imitates a weak and crippled fish.
I think we've dropped, Dave, I think we've dropped it here again, the mud weight.
Look how clear it is.
It's like drinking water.
It helps if, like David and Alan, you are a good naturalist. They try to think like a pike, where the fish should be, autumn, winter, spring or summer.
Well, as a pike angler, you really want to be one step ahead of what the pike are doing at any particular time of the year. Summertime is probably the most difficult time because they spread out in pursuit of the prey. And then here, like autumn again, the prey fish tend to bunch up again, and particularly in shallower, weedier areas, and clearly the pike know that. The pike move in and feed on them again.
Pike are hunting in this bay, but getting one to the boat isn't that easy. They have to be encouraged to attack the lure first.
The type of fishing we're going to do is a form of teasing the fish, to all intents and purposes, like dangling a ball of wool in front of a cat. Those fish that want to chase will chase, and it's fantastic. They'll chase it like a bloody toy. We actually antagonize them by repeated casting.
In, Dave?
No. Gone, Alan.
Is it?
Yeah.
Was it fish?
Yeah. Spectacular taste.
As it usually happens when we're not expecting it. And so you drop your guard for a split second and bang, they're on.
So there, I assume, lying there, and if a nice, easy target or an easy meal comes into vision, they'll have a go.
Yeah! Yeah.
Dave. She's on. Fish on. Well gone.
It's lovely, lovely.
She's beautiful.
Oh, she's pulling, yeah. Oh, she's nice. She's only a little one. 10 or 11, maybe.
Lovely fish.
Look at the gash marks there.
She's been hit by another bigger fish.
That's it.
Back you go.
There's a few nice fish in the area. Well done. Great zero goal.
So, what now?
Catch a bigger one.
Get a bigger one.
Well, we know there's a 30 in here. We've seen her. She's come to the boat. She's taken a lure and she's tail walked to the boat, threw the lures in her face and headed off again. So we're after her.
In the end, size is what really matters. 30 pounds is the magic figure, a catch of a lifetime. But the Holy Grail is a fish much, much bigger.
They're few and far between, but those that are there can be huge.
That's what we're really interested in, catching monster pike.
We also love nature. You see wildlife, beauty, the changing colours of the light coming from the ocean over the hills and whatever. And it is beautiful. And we're experiencing that often in very bleak, wild spots. And that's what's wonderful about it.
Wild primitive fish and wild primitive surroundings.
To be happy fishing here, you need to be prepared for the lonely, brooding wilderness of these lochs. And perhaps even to be a little frightened.
Loch Corrib is a very strange lake. It's a very, very deep, dark lake. There's an old story where these divers were putting down markers. And just off Ashford Castle, he put down a marker on this rock where there was a pike hole beside it. And he must have disturbed the pike, but this pike came out of the hole. The diver reckons he was 6 foot long. 6 foot, I don't know how many pounds. They came in terrified. They thought they were diving in safe waters, but the fish they saw were huge and frightening. So I don't think they'll dive in it again.
Maybe someday we might hook a pike, like the French guy saw.
But you don't scare pike anglers that easily. These are just the sorts of stories they want to hear. It draws them like a magnet. And nothing, not even the Irish weather, can dampen their determination to scour every inch of the loch.
Well, I think it's time for a change of bait. Change a look.
Are you getting wet up there?
We're getting what?
Getting wet.
Getting wet?
I'm gonna dissolve. You want to see it on a bad day?
Got a distinct feeling of fishing into the wind here. You know, Christ, it's like fishing on a damp mat.
I'm quite confident. I think we'll catch fish. It has to be said, though, you don't come here to catch huge numbers of pike.
The next one might be the big one. It could be a 5, it could be a 50, you know.
Oh dear, look at this, Howard. Look.
There's a big twister building up. It's going to come straight towards us.
I think it's time for a Guinness.
It's just getting a bit too hairy there.
Sometimes the elements do win.
The biggest problem around here is the sheer size of these waters. These are vast open areas of you know, reefs and islands and dark corners, and it's terribly unpredictable. We would perhaps liken it to the searching for the needle in the proverbial haystack.
Searching for monsters has been going on here too, for as long as people can remember. This river can cast its own eerie spell. Paul Gustafsson is never happier than huddled at dawn on this, his favourite stretch of the River Thames. Giant pike are on his mind too.
It's taken nearly a lifetime to get to know this river, and there is no shortcut to find out where the pike are going to be at any one given moment in time. My ambition is to break the Thames record, which stands at 33 pounds. This section of river is quite capable of producing fish of that size. I've had them here to 29 pounds. I've never had a 30 pounder from here, but I know they exist. And two seasons ago, I lost an enormous fish out here.
As well as that one that got away, Paul knows big pike are hunting hereabouts because sometimes he can see them. A little upstream is a weir pool, that in the summer is absolutely crammed with fish in search of oxygen-rich water. Bream, roach and chub. And following them, exploiting the bounty, are the local pike.
Pike, very much like the lions on the Serengeti. The lions stay in touch with the wildebeest. So the pike stay in touch with the food fish.
Once the winter comes, the prey fish move back downstream to where the feeding is best, and the pike follow them. Now Paul lies in wait, preparing to catch. Pike will happily scavenge winter casualties, and Paul hopes a small dead fish lying on the bottom might look like an easy meal to tempt an opportunistic pike. A twitch on the line sometimes helps the deception. If a pike suspects something is up, it can spit out the hooks in the blink of an eye. A 30-pound log. This stretch of river is full of tangles. A fresh bait and another try.
Man, it doesn't feel a bad one.
Looks a double figure fish. He's only just taken that bait. It hasn't gone down deep. And they're very lethargic at the moment because the temperature of the water is absolutely freezing. And we'll just slip him into that net. And that's the first fish of the day. And what a beautiful looking pike that is. The perfect predator. They're a design classic. And they're absolutely magnificent.
Magnificent, yes. But not exactly a monster. But big pike do exist. The largest recorded officially in this country is in the annals of the Cheltenham Corporation Waterworks of 1896. Their reservoir was a popular venue for trout fishing. And among the records of trout catches was a note. Someone had landed a pike, 4'6" long and weighing 60 pounds. Unfortunately, the truth later emerged, the pike may never actually have been weighed. They'd just sort of guessed. However, it seems that pike had lived in the reservoir alone and unmolested for years, eating as many trout as it liked, and it had just grown and grown. Perhaps that's the sort of place to look for the really big one. This is Llandegford Reservoir in Wales, well stocked with trout and where the British record pike was caught. And on the odd special day, an army of pike anglers are permitted to come here and try their luck. Taking a break from pursuing Irish pike and ever hopeful, David joins local pike expert Howard Yendall. Howard has an idea or two where the pike might be.
Look, it's not out to us.
With all those trout to eat, the pike here do grow big. The record was just over 46 pounds, and she was put back. She's had 3 years to grow since then. Who knows how big she is now?
The hairs on the back of your neck started to go in. Start thinking about 50-pound fishing, you do.
It's a big fish, this, very big.
Is it?
Yeah.
30?
It's getting on that way. If it's not, it's very close.
Easy. Got it. Yep, she's it.
Thanks for that.
Some anglers are beginning to strike gold.
Ooh. It's a big fish. Ooh, girl, whoa. Here she goes.
It's on the green.
20.
27. 27.
27.
Yeah.
That's a good result. Not over yet. I think there's probably more to come as well. Because these fish didn't come out first thing. They're still coming out at this time of day, which is quite encouraging. I would think there's a few more to come out, yeah.
You mean the chances of catching fish like that on carib within 2 hours of the start? Very difficult. Very difficult. I would honestly say it's probably as far removed from the kind of places that we fish regularly as it's possible to get. Certainly never see this many boats, that's for sure.
And there's still a 50 swimming out there. Could be looking at your lure.
Chance would be a fine thing.
Yes, it would.
I wished on the moon for something I never knew.
But the luck seems to be with other boats. All around, everyone else seems to be catching.
As I look over my shoulder, Paul Jennings is into a fish. I kid you not. So we're trying everything we have in the lure box, really, with no success so far.
You asked if there was a secret weapon if things get really tough, you know? Well, there is. What self-respecting pike could resist that? You know, I mean, what can you do with that? How can you possibly resist that? It's got that sort of Marilyn Monroe look about it. But it would actually fish. I mean, it was done as a bit of a joke, to be honest, but it would fish. You know, there's no reason why it wouldn't catch fish. That's definitely the secret weapon. If things get really tough, you'd be reduced to trying that.
Don't put the Marilyn Monroe away just yet, Howard.
Jeez.
Some anglers, alas, not Howard or David, seem to have stumbled on a hot spot. This is their fourth fish, and it looks really big.
Must go close on 30, if not.
Bigger, yeah.
The red. 31.8. 31.8. Well done, mate.
31 and a half pounds. Now that is a very rare fish. A pike hunter's dream. And it's in another man's arms.
All right. Enjoyed that. Thanks, mate.
Excellent.
Oh, that's the one we've come for.
Yep.
We can do with another one now, a bit bigger. Such a damn big fish. Face it out to sea. What we've got to do is hold them by the tail while they get their oxygen back into the gills, recover slightly. Beautiful, it's a better sight than catching it, see it go away. Oh, enjoyed that.
For David, coming all this way without success, isn't that just a bit frustrating?
Not frustrated at all, and I'm used to not catching fish.
Not over till the fat lady sings. We might manage a few, yeah.
I'm looking forward to going home and catching some fish in places where I know they live.
David's right to head for home. You have to keep the faith. And after all, as everyone knows, the west coast of Ireland is where the biggest pike of all come from. As Eddie will tell you, another pint and another story.
Well, an old story about two locals in off the River Shannon who were coming home late one night. And they heard this big splash. And what it was, a pike that had stranded himself up on the shore. Apparently, it was chasing perch. So they went down to it, and they killed it with an old oar that was lying on the side of the shore. And after they finished killing it, they brought it to the local landlord. Who weighed it? It was 92 pounds, so the story goes. So if it's 92 pounds, it would be the biggest pike ever caught. That's an old story, 200 years old. A lot of pints of Guinness over the 200 years. So if that pike was 92, I'd love to see him.
I think fish like that could exist. I mean, why not? If you can get a man who's nearly 9 foot tall, you know, and the average might only be 6 feet tall, of course they can still exist. They really are freaks of nature every now and again. Maybe once in 100 years somebody turns one up. And just at some stage I hope it's me.
Fish, good fish. Good fish.
Is it?
Oh, look at this. We're in a big one, Frankie. Yeah. I need a net badly. Anyone got a net?
No, I'll handle it for
you. Oh, yeah. Beauty. You lovely, lovely girl, you. Come on, baby. You lovely girl. Show us what you mean. Look at the lovely colours on her. She's 20, I'd say.
Huh?
She's a 20.
Oh, she's coming again. I'm going to have to take her.
Come on. I got you, baby.
Yeah, she is. She's a good 20.
She's 20. I was afraid I'd lose her there. Yee-hoo! Ollie, Monica! What a magnificent beast. Sit down. Come on, baby.
But how big is she?
She's 22. 20.
Yeah, 24 three quarters.
Get me my camera there.
38 and a half. Sorry. The lovely fish.
Okay.
Okay, baby. Hope you keep bringing it to your grandmother. One of her own. Gently back with it. All these lovely pike deserve care and attention that we can afford them. They give us wonderful sport. And they're wonderful, wonderful, wonderful creatures. We're after now the great-grandmother. If she's a granny, we're after a great-grandmother.
Searching for those giant pike captures the angler's imagination perhaps more than anything else. But the truth, that's hard to unravel. Tantalizing half-remembered catches, stories swapped in bars.
Well, the fisherman's hands move as the years go along. They get a little bit bigger. They all get older and they get a bit bigger. Next guy will like to make the story a bit better for his side, so a few more pounds will go on. So the fish get bigger as the story is told, and bigger and bigger. So really, we don't know where it started.
Life is too short to fish for 40-pound pike or 50-pound fish, but we keep trying.
I do like to think that the very, very big fish are here. And really I think that's what, secretly that we're after. Maybe you'd need three or four lifetimes for that one.